Good afternoon. During today's hearing, we will receive stakeholder testimony on Native priorities for the 2023 reauthorization of the Farm Bill. Our goal is to consider these priorities with an eye towards compiling a bipartisan bill with the full support of the entire committee. I want to thank the Agriculture Committee Chairman Stabenow and Ranking Member Bozeman for being such great partners in advancing Native priorities in the Farm Bill. The 2018 Farm Bill was the first to meaningfully expand USDA program support for Native producers and Native communities. From tribal self-governance expansion to new authorities for forest co-management, the 2018 Farm Bill was a big step forward. But it was just a start, and we can and should build on that progress. For the upcoming reauthorization, Native stakeholders are calling for additional support, self-governance, and autonomy in food production, inspection and distribution, and management of natural and cultural resources, including forest resources. They're also seeking acknowledgement and incorporation of traditional ecological knowledge in USDA's conservation practice standards so that Native land stewards can use traditional conservation methods while also modeling best practices for others to follow. Most notably, Native communities are calling for wraparound navigator services, that is, targeted engagement for on-the-ground help to identify and apply for USDA grants, provide technical assistance with grant applications, and assist with compliance issues through the life of the grants. These are essential priorities for federal agriculture policy. American Indians, Alaska Natives, and Native Hawaiians have come together to advocate, engage, and be heard by Congress on their farm bill equities. And this committee in particular has been listening. In addition to regular engagement from Native stakeholder groups on their farm bill priorities, the committee worked diligently with member offices over the course of two Congresses, gathering and analyzing input from Native communities. So far, our record reflects testimony from the administration and Native producers on challenges with credit, insurance, infrastructure, access to markets, and technical assistance, numerous site visits to Native community farms, ranches, rivers, lakes, and fish ponds, multiple field hearings on the continent and in Hawaii, a roundtable discussion with community leaders, and the work continues with today's hearing, the next step towards our overall goal of developing a bipartisan bill. Before I turn to Vice Chair Murkowski for her opening statement, I'd like to extend my welcome and thanks to our witnesses for joining us today. I look forward to your testimony and to our discussion. Vice Chair Murkowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Really appreciate that we're here today to talk about the Native priorities within the 2023 Farm Bill. Really want to thank all the staffs, for the work that they have done in getting us to this place. You mentioned all the different steps that have brought us to this place, in addition to the roundtable that we had. Everything that we've put in place is just yet another step forward in progress. But we know we need to do so much here. Hunger and poverty in Indian country are significant reasons why the Farm Bill matters. One in four Native Americans rely on federally supported nutrition assistance programs in the Farm Bill. Alaska Native and American Indian communities pay more for food than the average consumer while also earning incomes well below the national average. In places in my home state, fresh vegetables, fresh fruit, basic staples, just more expensive because of travel and storage costs. Oftentimes you can't get anything fresh at all. So what we have in front of us is a major opportunity to support tribal producers, food sovereignty, and traditional ways of life. In the 2018 Farm Bill, we authorized a demonstration program that allows tribal governments to procure tribally produced foods for USDA food projects, and we did this by expanding 638 self-governance contracting authority to the food distribution program, the FDIPR. So as a result, more traditional, locally grown food is making it to the plates of Native elders and kids, but we need to take this further and expand the authority to the entirety of FDIPR, not just the sourcing. You've mentioned the forest management. I think we've got some opportunities here to expand self-governance at the USDA Forest Service. In 2018, again, we extended the 638 contracting authority for certain forest management activities on federal lands, including harvesting timber for subsistence and resources under the Tribal Forest Protection Act, but the authority is underutilized. I think we have seen the Forest Service approve only about a dozen agreements over the last 20 years, and only a handful of those utilize in any way the 638 authority. Based on what we've heard from tribal leaders, this tool isn't working as intended, and so what more we can do there to develop a legislative proposal to bring meaningful self-determination and self-governance authorities to the USDA and Forest Service, again, is going to be one of my priorities as we move forward. I want to extend a special welcome and thanks to President Peterson from Central Council of Tlingit and Haida. He's participating virtually today. Tlingit Haida has been a leading advocate for greater tribal self-determination across the board, including with respect to traditional food systems and incorporating traditional practices into forest and land management. I think we're going to hear President Peterson talk about his efforts on the 638 agreement with the Forest Service as it relates to Mendenhall Glacier. So I'm looking forward to hearing his comments on expanding 638 authorities at USDA and all that that can do to make a difference, particularly in Southeast Alaska. Mr. Chairman, thank you again for this hearing and for the good work of all of our committee members in advancing this.
Now turn to Senator Smith for introductory remarks.
Thank you so much, Chair Schatz and Vice Chair Murkowski. I want to just say how much I appreciate the chance to work with both of you on Native Farm Bill provisions. We've had many conversations about this, and I greatly appreciate it. And I'm really grateful for this committee's attention to the unique needs of Native and tribal communities in this upcoming Farm Bill. You know, I serve as both a member of this committee as well as a member of the Agriculture Committee, along with Senator Lujan and Senator Hoven. And I represent a state with 11 sovereign tribal nations and a very strong ag sector. So these issues are very close to my work and very close to my heart. For months, this committee has been working to create the building blocks of a strong Native Farm Bill, and I want to thank everybody who I've had a chance to work with on this, especially Senator Hoven and Senator Mullen, who we've been working together on various provisions, as well as many others. I know that this hearing today is going to focus on our ongoing effort to build a strong bipartisan Native Farm Bill that expands self-governance, that boosts Native agriculture, ranching, forestry, and food production, and makes sure the tribal priorities are included in every title of the Farm Bill as we go forward. So thanks so much to our witnesses for being here today. I look forward to this discussion and the work that we can do together.
Thank you very much. Senator Hoven.
Thanks, Chairman Schatz. Appreciate it. I want to thank both you and Vice Chair Murkowski for holding the hearing. And I really look forward to the input that we'll receive. USDA plays a critical part in supporting our farmers and ranchers. There's over 80,000 American Indian or Alaska Native producers in farming and ranching, and they generate over $3.5 billion in ag sales each year. I'm on the Ag Committee as well, and when we wrote the 2018 Farm Bill, I was actually chair of this committee and worked on it as a member of the Ag Committee, as is Senator Smith and others here. We included 62 different provisions in the Farm Bill which benefited tribes in the current Farm Bill. And so now as we look to write the new Farm Bill, we need to be mindful of the kinds of things that we can do that are important in Indian country. And Senator Smith is right, you know, on top of it with the FDIPR Tribal Food Sovereignty Act. We actually put that legislation in as a pilot program, included it in the 18, and so now you're taking it and to an established program, and again consolidating the administration of it, which will streamline and improve it. So I'm really pleased to co-sponsor that legislation with you, Senator Smith, and I thank you for taking that initiative, which I think this, it's just a really cool program, and I think it's going to touch a lot of people, and it just already is, but a lot more people in Indian country in a very important way, and certainly reflects, you know, our belief in self-determination. Also, I want to commend Senator Peters and Senator Fisher on the Tribal Conservation Priorities Inclusion Act, which really gives Native Americans more say when it comes to the NRCS programs. And then also, I'm working with Senator Tester, who is a member of this committee, on bipartisan legislation that will greatly strengthen both the Livestock Forage Program and the Emergency Livestock Assistance Program, not just for tribal members, but for all farmers and ranchers. But because we have so many Native farmers and ranchers, it's a really important provision, particularly as we try to get this next generation into, you know, really young people like Senator Smith and Senator Murkowski and Senator Cortez Masto into get this next generation into farming and ranching. The average age overall for farmers and ranchers is about 60 years old. And there are a lot of hurdles to getting into farming and ranching. So we need to continue to provide these programs. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your indulgence. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Senator Mullen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm glad we're having this hearing today, and I would like to say a few words about the bill Senator Smith and I introduced, the Prime Meat Processing and Indian Country Act. I believe the Self-Determination and Education Assistance Act has been one of the most successful policy initiatives in Indian Country to date. 638 contracting has paved the way for federal Indian policy to be one of the most self-determinations and empowerment programs around. 638 contracting in Indian Country began with the Interior in 1970, and later HHS has brought it into the fold. Neither agency accepted with open arms broad changes to how business would be done within Indian Country. Nevertheless, tribes and agencies stayed the course and worked extremely well together. Now tribes manage over one half of the programs offered by BIA and IHS. I believe it's time for USDA to help move 638 contracting in a new direction within Indian agricultural. That's why Senator Smith and I came together and introduced the Prime Meat Processing in Indian Country Act. This straightforward bill gives tribes full 638 contracting authority for USDA's meat inspection process. I understand that 638 contracting with tribes is new to USDA. This process was new to Interior and HHS at one point. But there can be and there is some very talented people at USDA, and I believe they'll figure this out. Because no one can deny that 638 has been a gold standard within Indian Country. With that, I yield back.
Thank you very much. We'll now turn to our witnesses. And Senator Murkowski, if you'd like to introduce your witness from Alaska.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I briefly introduced President Peterson. As I mentioned, President Peterson is with the Central Council of Tlingit and Haida Indian Tribes of Alaska. Not only has President Peterson been leading on matters related to self-determination, he has been truly a leader when it comes to all aspects of Native governance, not only in the southeastern region, in the Tlingit-Haida region, but statewide. So it gives me great pleasure to be able to welcome him back to the committee today.
We're also pleased to welcome Mr. Davis Price, the Hawaii Regional Director of NDN Collective in Ewa Beach, Hawaii. Mr. Cody Desautel, President of the Intertribal Timber Council in Portland, Oregon. Ms. Abi Fain, the Director of Policy and Government Relations in the Intertribal Agricultural Council, Billings, Montana. And Senator Mullen, you have two witnesses to introduce.
I do. Thank you again for giving me time, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to introduce two Oklahomans to this committee. The first being Jay Spaan, a Cherokee citizen and executive director at Self-Governance Communication and Education Tribal Consortium in Tulsa. Earlier in his career, Mr. Spaan served as a senior analyst for GAO. We're very lucky to have someone with Mr. Spaan's skill and experiences promoting self-governance and self-determination policy inside Indian Country. I thank you, Mr. Spaan, for coming to D.C., and I'm excited to hear your ideas on how this farm bill can be best for all of us inside Indian Country. Second, I'd like to introduce Trent Kissee, Eastern Oklahoma Shawnee Tribe, member from Ottawa County, Oklahoma. I didn't want to mess that one up. I would have gotten in trouble when I went back to intercouncil. Mr. Kissee currently serves as the Director of Agricultural and Natural Resources at Muscogee Creek Nation. Trent is also one of many talented individuals running Muscogee Creek's looped square. Did I say that right? I know I've been to the facility. I just was making sure I had that right. Meat processing facility in Beggs, Oklahoma. Trent also serves on the board of Intertribal Agricultural Council. We are all very grateful to work with him and his guidance from the Intertribal Ag Council as we write the farm bill that works for Indian Country. Mr. Kissee holds an ag degree from the Oklahoma State, master's degree from OU. Very confused there, sir. I mean, Oklahoma State's kind of known for ag, but I got to tell you, I got one boy wrestling at University of Oklahoma, one boy wrestling at Oklahoma State, so I understand the confusion you have there. But we won't hold that against you or me, hopefully. Thank you, Mr. Kissee, for joining us here today.
Are they in the same weight class?
Unfortunately, yes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I'm trying to work that out. The other one I'm trying to have eat a little bit more.
Yeah, so, I wish you luck.
I'm going to wear a shirt when they wrestle each other that says it's white and says America on it.
Or Mullen. All right, we'll start with our witnesses, and we'll remind our witnesses that we have your full testimony as part of the written record, and we'd like you to confine your remarks to 5 minutes or even less if possible. We'll now start with Mr. Peterson. Please proceed with your testimony.
Good afternoon, Chairman Schatz, Vice Chair Murkowski, and honorable members of the Senate Committee on Indian Affairs. My name is Richard Peterson. My Tlingit name is Shakya Ish, and I am Kagwantan from the Eagle's Nest House. I grew up in the Haida village of Kisan, Alaska, and I have served as president of Central Council of the Tlingit and Haida Indian Tribes of Alaska since 2014. Tlingit and Haida is the largest federally and state recognized tribe in Alaska and the 12th largest tribe in the nation. I am grateful for the opportunity today to provide testimony on behalf of over 35,000 tribal citizens that we represent worldwide regarding our tribal priorities and our support for the expansion of authorities within the U.S. Department of Agriculture's 2023 Farm Bill. As Indigenous people, our connection to the land and waterways is not only deeply spiritual but practical, providing us with sustenance and resources vital to our existence. We advocate for co-management agreements that respect tribal sovereignty and traditional ecological knowledge while promoting cooperation between tribes and federal and state agencies to protect the delicate balance of our ecosystem. Tlingit and Haida serves over 18 villages and communities spread across 43,000 square miles, which is about the size of Kentucky, our traditional homelands here in Southeast Alaska. The management of traditional indigenous lands and waters is crucial to maintaining our way of life and is an expression of our sovereignty. Our shared ancestral lands and waters provide incredible opportunities for indigenous-led, large-scale collaborative projects that can connect and restore the lands, waters, and wildlife that are the foundation of our cultural existence and our economic welfare. Tlingit and Haida strongly supports the 2023 Farm Bill policies that can positively impact tribal self-governance and co-management opportunities, as well as economic development opportunities to sustain present and future generations of Alaska Native peoples. Tlingit and Haida recognizes and is grateful for the incremental steps that have been made through the Southeast Alaska Sustainable Strategy, for example, but current agreements are limiting in scope for both tribes and the USDA. First and foremost, the expansion of 638 and self-governance authorities is both an opportunity and an obligation for the federal government. As you know, the federal government has fallen short in implementing its trust responsibility to adequately address the unique challenges and opportunities faced by Indigenous communities, particularly here in Southeast Alaska. Self-governance and the co-management that can go hand in hand with it are not gifts to the tribes. They are a recognition that the federal government cannot and does not have the right to tell our history upon our homelands or to shape the future of this place without us at the table. I'd like to take a brief moment and share a personal story. Here in Juneau, we have the Mendenhall Glacier. The glacier is in our operated under the Department of Agriculture and receives over 1 million visitors each year for tourism. And while there on a funding tour with both federal representatives, state representatives, and municipal representatives, along with philanthropic groups, when asked where's the Tlingit people recognized here in this visitor center, the staff responded that the Tlingit didn't have anything to do with the glaciers. Now, that I can tell you that's incredibly offensive because my own clan and many others have migration stories. Our history is told about us traveling over, under, and through the volcano, through the glaciers. And that's even substantiated now in Western science when the remains of a man were found and dated back nearly 10,000 years and DNA tested to find living Tlingit relatives here now today. So our history is very important and a part of this landscape. And with that said, Tlingit and Haida is actively pursuing co-management of the Mendenhall Glacier Recreation Area and Visitor Center here in Juneau, Alaska. The Mendenhall Glacier Visitor Center attracts, as I said, over a million visitors each year. And as I mentioned, there's no acknowledgement of Indigenous peoples, our culture, or our history at this location managed by the U.S. Forest Service. This is a failure to tell the story of that place and that Tlingit and Haida seeks to remedy. More than enrichment, a visitor's experience that incorporates and fosters cross-cultural understanding and appreciation of our heritage and the rights to tell that story and promoting Indigenous-led tourism are incredibly important. Alaska tribes have a strong history and track record when it comes to the successful 638 compacts and contracts. The Alaska Tribal Health System speaks for itself as a resounding success for compacting. Tlingit and Haida was one of the first of 20 tribes in the U.S. to compact with the government and the very first to take on the full measure of self-governance, nearly shutting down the Bureau of Indian Affairs Southeast Regional Office. If compacting authorities are expanded to USDA, it is a win-win scenario for the federal government, tribes, and the public. As governments, we will finally have the tools to allow us to work together for the management of our lands and waters. Anything less than this self-governance would continue the gap between the rhetoric of co-management from our federal partners and the reality of what they can deliver using existing templates. Why recreate the wheel when it is 638 authority that has a demonstrated record for honoring Indigenous sovereignty and successful implementation? Our people have stewarded the traditional homelands and waters of Southeast Alaska since time immemorial. We are the experts of this place where we thrived and nourished our people for tens of thousands of years. Again, we seek to work collaboratively to enhance co-management and stewardship opportunities, not only for Alaska tribes, but to enrich the way that the U.S. agencies operate and understand our unique challenges and opportunities within our region. Tlingit and Haida is actively working to advance our regional greenhouse program to support our youth and elders. We have traditional potatoes, distinct potato varieties that have been proven to trace their roots to Peru, which has demonstrated our cultural, how far our culture and economies have stretched. Our traditional foods to be included on the list of approved foods for the food distribution program on Indian reservations. I realize, sir, I'm over time, so I thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you very much, sir. I'm happy to welcome and say aloha to Mr. Davis Price, the Hawaii Regional Director of NDN Collective, Ewa Beach.
Aloha mai kākou, or greetings. My name is Davis Price, and I'm the Hawaii Regional Director for NDN Collective. I am Kanaka Uiwi, or Native Hawaiian, and reside on the island of Oahu. I would like to extend sincere gratitude to Senator Schatz and Senator Murkowski for the opportunity to testify today, and for the community's diligent effort to include the voices of Native peoples in this highly impactful legislation. NDN Collective is a nationwide organization dedicated to empowering Indigenous communities to exercise our inherent right to self-determination. Since 2019, NDN has deployed philanthropic grants to over 700 Indigenous-led organizations and projects across the U.S. and its territories, from Puerto Rico to Guam. In Hawaii, NDN has deployed over $4 million in grants to Native Hawaiian-led projects. One of the core functions of our work is to foster and develop economic systems that center the transformative value of traditional ecological knowledge. Today, I would like to highlight the groundbreaking TEK work, traditional ecological knowledge work, that has been underway in Hawaii for many years. This aina-based or land-based work is happening across Hawaii and is focused on restoring culturally significant spaces that once supported a thriving population and food system that was completely self-sufficient. Today, Hawaii is grappling with the impacts of a rapidly changing natural environment, and our traditional Hawaiian management practices are providing a guiding metric for what once existed and what is possible in the future. Hawaii is the most isolated landmass on Earth, a small island chain in the center of the largest body of ocean on the planet that once supported an estimated population of 1 million people prior to Western contact with no imported goods. This is nearly the same size as the population today. However, today, Hawaii imports approximately 90% of its food, which leaves our entire island population extremely vulnerable to disasters, whether they be natural or man-made. This statistic has become a mantra of sorts in the Hawaiian community as a movement for self-determination, cultural revitalization, and reconnection to ancestral land has gained momentum. We know the solution to our own food insecurity and greater collective sustainability is grounded in our ancestral knowledge systems. For many years, most people overlooked the fact that Hawaii has become increasingly more dependent on outside sources of sustenance, such as importing nearly all of our food, while our land and water resources are utilized for other extractive economic purposes or neglected altogether. That was until the COVID-19 pandemic and subsequent economic shutdowns actually gave everyone a taste of what happens when the ships stop coming. Empty store shelves, spikes in gas prices, and limited access to the bare necessities were wake-up calls to many who probably hadn't paid much attention to how vulnerable we actually are in the middle of a vast ocean. Since that time, much more attention has been given to the work happening in the Native Hawaiian community to restore spaces that are not only culturally relevant to our community, but are also a glimpse into the economic bedrocks of a once thriving ecosystem, our traditional food system. A traditional food system is traditional ecological knowledge in Hawaii, and it is recognizable to indigenous communities throughout the country and around the globe. Indigenous ancestral knowledge systems most often highlight the capacity that humans have to enhance our environment, not only extract from it. This is the foundation of TEK, and it is imperative that we embrace the potential for a truly symbiotic relationship between our human societies and the environment. Developing these relationships better positions us to protect our resources and leave future generations with healthy environments that can continue to provide the resources they need for not only to survive, but to thrive. The conservation and research titles of the Farm Bill provide opportunities to codify the value of TEK and ensure that we continue to enhance conservation standards and practices. This also requires the compilation of data that measures the positive impacts of TEK-related work. There are many examples in Hawaii of restoration projects that focus on restoring land and food system resources, and we can visibly see the positive impacts of these projects. When traditional lo'ikalo or wetland taro fields are restored, the surrounding streams become healthier, native species return, and habitats are reinvigorated. When traditional loko'ia or fish pond spaces are restored, the shoreline reefs become healthier, the upland streams become healthier, and native species return. These are the magnificent outcomes when people are engaging the land to amplify the natural resources of the natural occurrences of Mother Nature and optimize the natural environment's capacity to produce food, true symbiosis. I've been a part of a small working group that has been gathering input from 70 Native Hawaiian food producers regarding this year's Farm Bill. In addition to being food producers, these are cultural, environmental, and community stewards. This group represents just a fraction of the work happening across Hawaii to achieve self-determination and develop solutions to some of the greatest challenges we collectively face in our island society. TEK is recognition that our indigenous communities around the world hold foundational knowledge that can help us mitigate the existential threats we face with rapidly increasing natural disasters. Inclusion of TEK into the conservation and research titles was just one of many recommendations from the Native Hawaiian producers and members of the Native Farm Bill Coalition. Mahalo, I am humbled to be just one voice amongst the many thousands of our ancestors and relatives that carry forth the work of our Lahui, Hawaii, or Hawaiian Nation. Mahalo for your time and consideration.
Thank you very much. We'll now hear the testimony of Mr. Desautel. Please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I'm Cody Desautel, President of the Intertribal Timber Council and Executive Director for the Confederated Tribes of the Kabwe Reservation. On behalf of the ITC and its more than 60 member tribes, I appreciate this opportunity to speak about the ITC's priorities for the next Farm Bill. We appreciate the work this committee and its members did to provide tribes with new authorities in the 2018 Farm Bill. In the years since, the ITC has worked with federal agencies and tribes across the country to make sure those authorities are understood and utilized. The growing risk of wildfire to Indian lands is compounded by the thousands of miles of shared boundary with federal agencies, primarily the U.S. Forest Service and Bureau of Land Management. There are countless examples of wildfires spilling over from federal lands onto tribal lands, causing significant economic and ecologic losses. Congress recognized the need for cross-boundary restoration, and the result was the Tribal Forest Protection Act of 2004. 2018 Farm Bill not only expanded that TFPA authority, but also gave tribes and counties the authority to enter into good neighbor agreements with federal agencies. Unfortunately, a drafting error in the final text precludes tribes or counties from retaining revenue generated from GNA projects for restoration services. GNA provides latitude in retaining project revenues needed to build additional tribal capacity to expand this work, as states have done since 2014. With respect to TFPA, the ITC recommends expansion of the TFPA authority. First, we would like to see the 638 contracting authority expanded to include additional Forest Service and BLM functions within the context of an approved tribal co-management or co-stewardship agreement. The secretaries would be authorized to carry out forest management demonstration projects by which tribes may contract to perform administrative, management, and other functions of federal programs under applicable co-management agreements in project planning areas of up to 50,000 acres. The ITC also recommends creating broad pilot authority for 638 agreements within USDA and beyond the TFPA structure. This could cover all of the Forest Service and NRCS. Other farm bill priorities, the bipartisan infrastructure law authorized increased pay for federal firefighters. However, the law has been interpreted to exclude firefighters operating under a 638 contract pursuant to the Indian Self-Determination and Education Assistance Act. Without statutory and administrative changes, these tribal firefighters are treated the same as contractors subject to the federal acquisition regulations. Such an interpretation fails to capture the unique relationship between tribes and federal agencies. In its FY24 budget justification, the Biden administration proposed legislation to establish a special base rate salary table for wildland firefighters, to create a new premium pay category that provides additional compensation for all hours a wildland firefighter is mobilized on an incident, and establishes a streamlined pay cap that provides waiver authority to the secretary using specific criteria. The ITC supports these recommendations and requests new legislation is inclusive of tribal firefighters working under 638 contracts. 2018 Farm Bill also authorized the Large Landscape Scale Restoration Program, which clearly intended to include Indian tribes. The ITC recommends a technical change to the statute to ensure tribal participation is not challenged in the future due to land classification. The Tribal Biomass Demonstration Project was authorized in Public Law 115-325 and directed the Secretary of Interior to enter into contracts and agreements with Indian tribes for biomass projects by providing reliable supplies of woody biomass from federal land. The demonstration project expired in 2021, and the ITC recommends an extension of this authority for 5 years to give tribes an additional opportunity. Lastly, the Small Isolated Parcel Conveyance Authority. Current law provides a process for conveyance of excess federal property to the Secretary of Interior when such property is located within the reservation of any tribe. The ITC recommends providing the Forest Service and BLM with pilot authority to convey small, isolated parcels of land to the Secretary of Interior to be held in trust when such parcels are adjacent to Indian lands and of such small size and isolation to make Indian forest management a more practical option for maintaining forest health and resilience. And with that, thank you for the opportunity to share my comments.
Thank you very much. We'll now hear from Ms. Abi Fain. Ms. Fain, please proceed.
Chairman Schatz, Vice Chair Murkowski, and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to submit testimony on behalf of the Intertribal Agriculture Council as it relates to agriculture priorities in tribal communities in 2023. My name is Abi Fain, and I am here in my capacity as the Director of Policy and Government Relations for the IAC, an organization headquartered in Billings, Montana, that has worked alongside tribal producers in their agriculture resource development for more than 35 years. I'm a citizen of the Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma and currently reside within the boundaries of the Muscogee Creek Nation Reservation. Prior to joining IEC, I had the opportunity to spend 8 years at law firms that represented tribal governments, tribal economic development entities, and tribal individuals. It was during this time that I began to learn more about tribal agriculture through Janie Hipp, the Chickasaw founder of the Indigenous Food and Agriculture Initiative, and most recently, General Counsel for the USDA, and the untapped opportunities in tribal agriculture, as well as existing hurdles for both tribes and individual tribal producers in their agriculture endeavors. Today, I appear as an extension of my colleagues at IEC who provide direct services to tribes and tribal producers throughout Indian Country to ensure they are equipped with information about available resources at USDA and have access to assistance to navigate these resources. For more than 3 decades, IEC has come before this committee on several occasions to emphasize the importance of agriculture in tribal communities and the need for laws that support tribes and individual tribal producers in accessing critical programs at USDA and the Department of Interior free of bureaucratic barriers. While great strides have been made in the last 35 years, much remains to be done. The upcoming Farm Bill marks a unique opportunity for Congress to ensure we continue to build momentum that supports the conservation, development, and use of tribal agriculture resources for the betterment of our people. For purposes of today's hearing, I'm going to focus my testimony on the value of technical assistance opportunities available at USDA. It is also important to consider how these proposals will impact tribal producers, whose livelihoods are inextricably linked to the laws that govern agriculture in Indian Country, to ensure that well-intended provisions achieve their purpose upon implementation. When IEC was founded in 1987, we were originally funded through the BIA. The lack of dedicated resources and funding available at the BIA prompted the IEC to look to the USDA for opportunities to develop Indian Country's agriculture resources. While IEC spent more than 2 decades working to improve tribal producers' access to USDA programs, it wasn't until 2010 that a technical assistance framework was developed for better addressing USDA service delivery in Indian Country. It was at this time that the IEC and USDA's Office of Tribal Relations began to work on an agreement that would establish a network of offices in different regions in Indian Country for the purpose of providing technical assistance to tribes and tribal producers. IEC's technical assistance network is at the heart of many of our efforts. We have approximately 20 technical assistance specialists who are strategically located in IEC's 12 regions that mirror BIA's regions. The objective of the network is to improve and enhance Indian participation in USDA programs, and in the last 10 plus years has worked to fill a void in delivery of programs to Indian Country to begin addressing tribal producers' lack of access to capital, exclusion from conservation programs, and USDA's historic failure to provide outreach to potential producers. While IEC's cooperative agreements with the USDA encompass technical assistance in Indian Country, these agreements are not the result of any one program enshrined in statute. Even so, these opportunities to enter agreements directly with multiple agencies at USDA have steadily increased over time. These represent a marked improvement at USDA that warrants continued growth and greater accessibility around these opportunities. When it comes to codifying technical assistance support, the IEC cannot overemphasize the value of outreach to tribal producers from technical assistance specialists who come from their same communities and are often producers themselves. Even so, we would caution that the language that is drafted to support this type of legislation be considerate of creating potential barriers at USDA. First, language around broad technical assistance requirements at USDA, depending on how written, might be interpreted as a quota that serves as a cap to these types of agreements. And second, the language, if not carefully drafted, could result in a program that lacks funding and support to adequately address the agriculture needs within Native communities. I see I've reached my time limit, but I want to thank you for this opportunity to discuss the importance of technical assistance outreach from community-based organizations and let you know that IAC remains available to talk about opportunities to draft language that would fulfill its intended purpose. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Fain. Mr. Kissee, please proceed with your testimony.
Chairman Schatz, Vice Chair Murkowski, and members of the committee, Mado, Niawe, thank you for the opportunity to be here today to discuss ways that the Farm Bill can better support agricultural production and the food supply in Indian Country. My name is Trent Kissee, and I am the Director of the Division of Agriculture and Natural Resources for the Muscogee Creek Nation. I'm also a citizen of the Eastern Shawnee Tribe and serve on the IAC Board of Directors representing Eastern Oklahoma. My family also raises beef and sells direct to consumer on our allotment land in Shawnee and Modoc territory. The Muscogee Creek Nation is the fourth largest tribe in the United States, and the Division of Agriculture and Natural Resources houses programs supporting tribal youth and producers and manages the nation's agribusinesses. Our Beef Cattle Ranch and Loop Square Meat Co., a USDA-inspected meat facility and retail space which features our own beef. The facility is located in a USDA-designated food desert, filling a much-needed void of fresh food access within the heart of our reservation. The nation operates robust FDIPR, WIC, child nutrition, and TANF programs. The retail space, which is open to the public, accepts SNAP. Feeding our people nutritious food and offering healthy choices for families in our community is of utmost importance to us. Since opening in December of 2021, Loop Square has served over 20,000 customers with fresh, wholesome, and nutritious food, some of which is grown and produced right there on the Muscogee Nation Reservation. I receive calls weekly from livestock producers and other tribes about entering the processing or the direct-to-consumer sales space. The food supply and the players involved are changing for the better, and sound Farm Bill policy can accelerate the enhanced security, sustainability, and fairness of our agricultural markets and food supply. One of the most effective ways to increase the efficiency and effectiveness of federal programming is to allow tribes to administer these programs ourselves. Tribal governments are sophisticated enough to carry out complex programming and know the nuanced needs specific to our individual communities. 638 compacts have proven successful in the delivery of some of the most critical services, and there is strong support in Indian Country for the expansion of 638 throughout USDA programs. Whether food procurement and distribution, disaster relief, or meat and food inspection, offering tribes the opportunity to compact federal programs expands opportunities within our communities, allows tribes to prioritize needs, and respects the sovereignty and uniqueness of each tribal nation. Recent investments in infrastructure and capacity were an important step in increasing the security and viability of our food supply by expanding processing capacity and market share for livestock producers and increasing choices and availability for consumers. Additional investments are needed in workforce development and technical assistance to ensure these operations can get off the ground in a good way and maintain the skilled workforce needed to meet the increasing demands for fresh, locally produced meat and other foods. Tribes throughout Indian Country offer an array of education benefits, scholarships, and training programs. Many tribal communities even have training centers or colleges like the College of the Muscogee Nation, which makes tribes a perfect conduit for increased investments in workforce development programs. Finally, Indian Country continues to push for parity throughout federal law and policy. In the Farm Bill, this would be particularly impactful, as tribes are often limited by rules and procedures set by state committees or governments. Decisions that affect tribal citizens and governments are best for everyone when those decisions are made respecting the tribe as sovereign nations, not when through the lens of varying tribal to state relations. Including tribal language where state and local governments, committees, and standards are mentioned is crucial. It is my honor to work towards stronger, healthier, and more sustainable communities in Indian Country. Tribal agriculture is thriving, but there is still work yet to be done. I look forward to the good this Congress can do with a new Farm Bill prioritizing the needs of tribes and tribal ag producers. Mado.
Thank you very much. Mr. Spaan, please proceed with your testimony.
Good afternoon, Chairman Schatz, Vice Chairman Murkowski, and members of the committee. My name is Jay Spaan. I'm a citizen of the Cherokee Nation and Executive Director for the Self-Governance Communication and Education Tribal Consortium. I also serve as an adjunct faculty at Arizona State University teaching courses on tribal self-governance. It is a great honor to be here today to share and discuss priorities for the 2023 Farm Bill reauthorization. I'm going to start with a few remarks about self-determination and self-governance authorities, and then quickly move to the Farm Bill priorities. For decades, self-determination contracting and self-governance compacting have proven to be effective mechanisms that tribal governments use for delivering federal programs to tribal communities. Nearly all tribes administer federal programs through self-determination contracts, and more than 365 tribes administer federal programs through self-governance compacts. While both self-determination and self-governance are authorized in the Indian Self-Determination and Education Assistance Act, or Public Law 93638, they are each distinct authorities and mechanisms with their own attributes, benefits, and regulatory framework. Self-governance was developed as a tribally driven initiative to improve upon and move beyond the limitations that tribal nations experienced when taking over administration of programs using self-determination. As such, self-governance authority provides tribes with greater flexibility and more efficiencies. For instance, under self-governance, tribes have the authority to revise federal programs in ways that will better address local needs without federal interference. Self-determination authority differs in that it requires tribes to submit redesigned proposals for federal review and approval. Overall, self-governance authority facilitates tribes using federal funds more effectively because they can integrate related resources to reduce fragmentation, redesign programs, and waive some federal agency rules that can hinder local solutions. It also reduces administrative and reporting burdens, allowing more focus on program delivery. Moving to priorities for the 2023 Farm Bill reauthorization, I respectfully offer the following for your consideration. First, the Food Distribution Program for Indian Reservations Self-Determination Demonstration Project has already demonstrated success incorporating local, higher quality, and more nutritious foods into tribal programs. The program is also boosting local economies. To build upon that success, Congress could include self-governance compacting, not just self-determination contracting, as a tribal option for delivery of the program. Congress could also expand the authority for the entirety of FDIPR, not just the sourcing opportunity. Expanding authority beyond the sourcing provision, along with the addition of self-governance authority, will provide tribal governments the ability to quickly respond to the unpredictability of growing seasons and current economic conditions. Two, allow tribal nations to directly administer their supplemental nutrition assistance programs with the option to use self-determination or self-governance authorities. Number three, remove statutory prohibition for individuals that qualify for both FDIPR and SNAP. Doing so would allow tribal governments to develop more comprehensive approaches to address food insecurity in their communities. Number four, allow tribal nations to assume administration for meat processing inspections, again, with the option to use either self-determination or self-governance authorities. Conducting inspections for food service licensing is something that tribes are very familiar with already and often do under their IHS self-governance compacts. Through this process, they're ensuring compliance with applicable federal, tribal, and state laws, and there's no reason to believe that we wouldn't have similar success under this program. Number five, direct USDA to prioritize and dedicate funding for additional tribal forest management self-determination demonstration projects. Six, direct the USDA to determine the feasibility of self-governance demonstration projects for additional USDA agencies and programs, including rural development programs, conservation programs, rural utility service programs, and additional food nutrition programs such as women, infant, and children. We believe the study should be conducted by a work group that includes both tribal and federal representatives that collectively demonstrate knowledge of USDA programs, self-determination authority, and self-governance authority. For programs the department deems feasible for self-determination or self-governance, Congress could provide USDA with the authority to move forward with for the agency to initiate these type of projects. Demonstration projects have proven to be a successful approach for identifying how tribal nations and federal agencies can implement new program delivery models and to identify any obstacles that need to be addressed before widespread rollout. Lastly, establish an Office of Self-Governance at USDA. An Office of Self-Governance could help with successful implementation by serving as a central point of contact within the department to help educate USDA agencies and programs. Thank you for the opportunity to present priorities for the 2023 Farm Bill reauthorization to the committee. This completes my prepared statement.
Thank you very much. Senator Smith.
Thank you very much, Chair Schatz, and thanks to all of you, and Vice Chair Murkowski. Thanks very much to all of you for being here. Mr. Spaan, I think that your testimony sort of touched on everything that I'm hoping we can accomplish in the Native Farm Bill, so I really appreciate that. And let me just dive in a little bit on this question of self-governance. And Ms. Fain, I'm going to come back to you too. So I think that the history of self-governance and self-determination has really proven that tribes are the best stewards of federal resources. And so what we did in the last Farm Bill was to include the first ever self-governance programs at USDA. I want to thank Senator Hoven and others. A lot of us worked on that in the pilot project for FDIPR. But now the question is, how do we build on this and how do we take it to the next level? So could you, each of you, just talk briefly about why the self-governance for SNAP and FDIPR, you know, what it would mean for tribes and tribal citizens as we work to move this forward. Please, Ms. Fain, go forth.
Sure. Both of those opportunities, I think the benefits are twofold. With regard to FDIPR, you're providing opportunities for fresher, higher quality food products. Right. To the community members, you're also supporting opportunities for a new market for tribal producers mm-hmm. who don't have that to rely upon. But when the tribes are able to make those determinations for the good of their community, they can either rely on their own ag operations or work directly with tribal producers who have otherwise been unable to participate in that type of program. And then within SNAP, it is an opportunity for to administer a program at the local level mm-hmm. and to achieve a greater efficiency and a greater impact because the administration of the program is happening on the ground by the government most familiar with the people that program is supposed to be serving.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Would you like, I want to just pull you into this and get your take on this. And maybe you could also talk about why having a dedicated office of self-governance would be helpful to an agency that, by its own admission, doesn't have a ton of experience working with 638 authority and other kinds of self-governance.
Yes, thank you for that question. And I agree with everything that the prior witness mentioned as far as the benefits. You know, we're also seeing that it's invoking a sense of pride in the mm-hmm. customers of the food distribution programs, that they're very proud to go in and mm-hmm. see Oneida beef, Oneida buffalo in their food distribution program. In fact, at Oneida Nation, they found that one of the approved food lists was catfish, and they had swapped it out for local whitefish. However, because the beef and the buffalo were coming directly from Oneida, that was just going off the shelves like crazy. Mm-hmm. And they actually had to change out and implement and bring in more beef and more buffalo and substitute it for the fish because people were so proud to see that it was locally grown and locally produced. So I think that there's a lot of benefits to these programs. I think that the Office of Self-Governance, the benefit is that, you know, we have heard the USDA express concern about having the capacity or the knowledge of right. to be able to negotiate with tribes. Mm-hmm. We think that an Office of Self-Governance or even a single point of contact could really help to educate all the different programs. You know, USDA is a huge, massive organization and lots of different departments. So having somebody that has that knowledge about what is self-governance, what is self-determination, and helping guide the rest of the agency and the rest of the programs through, we feel like that'd be very beneficial. It would also help building that internal capacity. And once more authorities are provided, then that office could start handling being the primary point of contact for negotiations mm-hmm. with tribes across all USDA, mm-hmm. either sitting in. There's similar approaches at IHS where they have agency lead negotiators that will sit in and they focus just on negotiations process. So I see something similar for USDA as a benefit.
Thank you. Mr. Chair, if I could just ask, I'm going to just take a little bit more time. I really appreciate that, and I think that, you know, the USDA has relied on other federal agencies when it comes to doing this kind of contracting, and it seems to me high time that they develop their own expertise and their own capacity to do this, which the Office of Self-Governance could accomplish. Last thing I just want to touch on is that, I mean, in my conversations with the Native Farm Bill Coalition and others, and the it has become clear to me that we need to look through all of the titles of the Farm Bill to look for places where we can ensure that issues of equity for tribal producers and agriculture are addressed. And even the USDA continues to, on a journey, I will say, they continue on a journey of addressing equity in all of its work, something that I know Secretary Vilsack and Deputy Secretary Torres Small are committed to. So let me just ask as a follow-up, do you think it is important that we look through all of the titles of the Farm Bill to make sure that we are looking for those issues of equity where we can address them?
Absolutely. I completely agree with that. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your leadership on both committees, Senator Smith. Senator Mullen, likewise.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Kinsey, Muscogee Creek Nation obviously is very lucky to have the ability to have a dedicated USDA inspector in your meat processing plant, and very fortunate to be able to get that. However, other tribes and other businesses have to rely on a traveling inspector, which means they're very limited on when they can process the proteins. How does that affect the bottom line for these other tribes and businesses out there?
Sure, and actually the FSIS inspector that we have on site now was formerly a traveling inspector, and so he talks a lot about the fact that he's glad to be in one place. It's frustrating for the USDA as they try to fill those gaps. It's hard to project for the businesses, so because I have an inspector on site every day if we need them, I can set our schedule, whether that's bringing in new producers or our own livestock from the ranch. I'm a little more easily able to forecast that need out. It helps with staffing because, you know, I'm not going to have a bunch of guys standing around all day because someone couldn't show up or because another plant needed the inspector. Having that dedicated inspector on site every day, it goes a long way. And, you know, I have a great staff. I have no complaints about the staff, but it also helps just having that extra set of eyes and that accountability on the cleaning staff, on the staff as they go about their day. Having that dedicated staff on site every day goes a long way in ensuring cleanliness and wholesomeness and safety of the product. But from the business standpoint, like I said, it just keeps log jams from happening. It keeps me from having to turn away customers because I'm not sure when or what day I'm going to be able to carry out slaughter and processing, because you have to have a USDA inspector on site for both of those activities. So you can run custom, you can run custom exempt, but then the customer that brings that livestock in is limited with what they can do with that animal. So it limits their marketability as well.
So you have one dedicated inspector, right?
Yes, sir.
So what happens if an emergency takes place and he can't be there that day?
So the responsibility then would fall to the USDA to get a substitute, which has only happened one time, and thankfully we were able to pull from another plant that that was not doing any slaughter that day. But it does create issues. Like I said, we've only been open a year and a half, and it's only happened once, but it can create issues. At that point, the frontline supervisor has to call all the plants kind of within the region. You know, Eastern Oklahoma, as you well know, Senator, is fortunate. We have several. We have four tribally owned and several other locally owned meat processing facilities. A couple are USDA inspected as well. So we sort of have a pool that makes us a little bit unique in terms of Indian country meat processing facilities. But, I don't want the record to show that as the norm, because it's not. Tribes throughout Indian country are in remote areas. Difficulty getting processors. I'm, you know, an hour away from the next nearest plant, and some maybe three or four more hours away from the nearest inspected plant. So that creates even more issues, not in Eastern Oklahoma.
So do you feel like if we would have 638 and tribes were allowed to do their own inspections, would it be able to increase liability and production in the areas to which they serve?
I believe so, and just as a general stance, I'm always in favor of self-governance and using 638 compacting when appropriate. I know there may be some issues in terms of, you know, just kinks that need worked out in the negotiations with tribes and staff. And again, all tribes are unique, and that's why these compacts are important, because it allows tribes to negotiate directly with the agency to come up with a solution that works best for them. If we were looking at marketability and things, as long as there's parity there with the federal inspector and the tribal inspector, so that there's there's no limitations on what a tribe can do on their with their product inspected by the tribal inspector. That would be fantastic. I know the CFR in Section 9 already talks about voluntary inspection, which is for and export. So whether that is non-immutable species such as bison, what voluntary means is the USDA will inspect it, but you're charged a fee. You have to reimburse them for that cost. And so it's not like beef and pork, which is taxpayer funded. The facility is responsible for non-immutable species, bison or venison or other products, buffalo. And the same would be true for the export certification. So you can be a non-USDA inspected facility and meet export criteria. You just have to do that on a voluntary basis currently. So as long as there were no limitations put on the tribes, if they do choose to go the 638 route, I would be in full support.
Thank you. Ma'am, quickly, we've heard concerns from USDA that implementing 638 authority for meat inspections would be difficult and impractical at the agency. What's your thoughts on that?
My thought is that where there is opportunity to improve the agency's government-to-government relationship, then that needs to happen. And even if that takes time and space for people to get comfortable with tribes in that space, at least from IAC's view, it is always our position that we are to support tribal sovereignty, and 638 is a component of that, including with the FSIS services.
And in your experience, though, tribes have been able to do the job with HHS and BIA, correct?
Absolutely. Tribes have undertaken very complex systems in life and death situations, especially when it comes to IHS in particular. And I think that's something that we always encourage agencies to understand, that you know, there are other models. While they may not be identical to what it looks like to for a transition with regard to meat, that there was a process in place for tribes to build out the program and make sure that there is not a gap in services or some other risk that might justify not going down that route. And so generally, I always like to share the really complex systems that tribes have taken over. And again, I'm fortunate to get to work throughout Indian country, but having grown up in Oklahoma, have been able to see that firsthand, especially through my own tribe and the services that they provide.
It's a great panel when everybody there has Oklahoma ties, ma'am. Can't get something better than that. Thank you.
Senator Mullen, I really appreciate what you have kind of worked out here, in the sense that, look, every agency that has had to take that first step, whether it was within Interior, BIA, we've got some examples in Alaska between Park Service, where Park Service is not working as well as Forest Service when it comes to the 638 compacting. And it's a little bit of a learning curve, and I think with some of the agencies, it really is a matter of bringing them along. This is not that scary. It can be done, and it can be done in a way that meets the needs of all involved. And I really appreciate the conversation that you had with Mr. Kissee about what happens if you don't have that that individual that can be on site when you're ready to go to slaughter. I went out to Nunavak Island. Look at it on a map. It's off the coast of Alaska, community of Mokoryuk. And Mokoryuk is known for musk ox and caribou, and reindeer. And they are really anxious to try to get a small a livestock production facility. They had one before. They've got the facility that they've built. I saw it. They're ready to go. But their biggest challenge is you're not going to be able to get a USDA inspector out there for the inspection to look at the cleanliness of the facility, to be there for the slaughter. And so how do you bring along this nascent industry in a remote area like that? But the tribe stands ready. and are anxious for what you and Senator Smith have really been working hard on. So I commend you for those efforts. But I think we just need to get these agencies used to it. You can show them, again, we're not recreating the wheel here. There are good examples. Sometimes capacity can be a bit of a challenge, but we help with that. We help with that. And the tribes have demonstrated time and time again that they will surpass all of the expectations, all of the naysayers that said, you can't do this, you can't do it. But we've got to make that possible. I want to ask a question to you, President Peterson, because you have raised the issue of the Forest Service and the potential for management at the visitors center out there and what true management authority could look like for Tlingit, Haida there at Mendenhall. And it really kind of hurt to listen to your story about the response from Forest Service that the Tlingit people had nothing to do with the glacier. It completely ignores, again, the history of the people, the history of the region, and really a very offensive statement by probably somebody who was not very well informed. So if you can, in the 2 minutes that I've given you here, explain what you think management authority would look like for Tlingit, Haida there at Mendenhall Glacier.
Well, thank you, Senator Murkowski, and your staff for all your work. To me, I think that co-management, what that looks like for us is coming in and really taking over the tours, hiring, staffing, and making sure that everybody has that base education and understanding of not only the area, it's an important scientific area because of the glacier receding and all those things. So you need to have a baseline on those sciences, but it's incredibly important also to have the true history of the area, the people of the area, and to understand that. So when those visitors come and are looking for that experience, that we're able to fully give that experience. And so we're looking at not only those staffing needs, but also for all the maintenance and infrastructure needs there as well, so that we're there offering a first-class experience to our nation's resources.
So if this is a matter of Forest Service needing congressional authority, would a demonstration program be helpful, or have you given much thought to that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it would be incredibly helpful. And we've met with everybody from Secretary Vilsack, Assistant Secretary Homer Wilkes, and they've all, said they really want to work with us and have us take over the management of this visitor center. But they always come back with the lawyer saying they don't have the ability to do it. And we know that 638 contracting is that tool. Right. We have a really long history with IHS, with Department of Interior on 638 contracting.
You absolutely have and have demonstrated that time and time again in a very good and strong way. Thank you for being part of this committee this afternoon and for your words. We'll look forward to working with Tlingit, Haida under your leadership.
Good cheese to you, Aunt Falaki.
Thank you very much, Senator Murkowski. Senator Lujan, followed by Senators Cortez, Masto, and Daines.
Thank you to our chair and vice chair for this important conversation. As more and more legislation is being established, built, filed to make a positive difference, especially in the area of food security and addressing problems that have been identified with pilot programs and things of that nature. So thank you all for being here. This week, I'm proud to introduce the Tribal Nutrition Flexibility Act and the Tribal Nutrition Program Administration Act to improve FDIPR, which, as we all know, is the Food Distribution Program. One of the things that my bill addresses is the need for greater tribal ownership over program implementation and flexibility to source traditional and local foods. My first question, Ms. Fain, yes or no, did the FDIPR 638 pilot result in higher take rates with traditional and tribally procured foods?
From what we have gleaned from the pilot tribes, the answer is yes. And one of the interesting examples that Mr. Spaan shared was about Oneida, and they had actually entered into an agreement with Menominees, and Menominees were purchasing Oneida-produced, I think it was Black Angus beef, and what was shared by Menominee was that they saw a significant increase in program participation, and the general excitement around the food that was actually coming through through their offerings. And so some of the things that I think are important to note about that is, and again, one that was brought up was those tribes that were able to do that know what is the right type of food for the region there. And I believe it was Mississippi Choctaws replaced some of the vegetables in their package with vegetables that are more appropriate for Mississippi and the southern region of the U.S., whereas tribes that haven't been able to participate in that program, some we have heard from, especially in the Great Plains region, where they're like, we have a whole lot of whitefish left over. We want beef or we want bison. And so I think for those pilot tribes in particular, there was really good participation and an increase in more appropriate foods by region, by season, things that the nationwide administration don't necessarily take advantage of because the framework doesn't permit it.
Well, I hope we can strengthen that and learn from it. Now, President Peterson and Mr. Spaan, yes or no, would increased sourcing flexibility under FDIPR, the food distribution program, help more tribes include more traditional and tribally procured foods in their packages? President Peterson?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Appreciate it. Mr. Spaan?
Yes, I agree.
Ms. Fain, yes or no, would increased sourcing flexibility have allowed tribes to better meet the needs of program participants during supply chain shortages caused by the COVID-19 pandemic?
Absolutely, it would.
And likewise, added flexibility to source regional and local ingredients can help support more, as we've seen, with those Title I programs. Now, Mr. Kissee, yes or no, does the Muscogee Creek Nation FDIPR program currently allow local, tribally raised and processed beef to be included in the food packages?
No, not yet, Senator.
I hope we can fix that. And yes or no, would you agree that added flexibility to include these types of locally and regionally produced products is important to address food insecurity?
Absolutely.
I appreciate that very much. Ms. Fain, yes or no, do you agree that the federal government should remove the cost match for tribes administering FDIPR on tribal lands?
Yes, definitely.
Well, I appreciate that very much. And another bill that I've been proud to work on, I'll enter this into the record, Mr. Chairman, and to our vice chair, is around farmer-to-farmer education, which would allow the USDA to contract with tribes and state-based organizations to provide technical assistance, outreach, and improve access to these conservation programs. These are important, but we need to ensure that everyone can access them. And by working with USDA and with state partners, I believe that we'll only grow those opportunities as well. So thank you for the time today, and I yield back.
Senator Cortez Masto.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me stay on the same vein of conversation, because I do appreciate my colleague, Senator Lujan, for what you're doing with respect to the food insecurity that I see amongst my tribes in Nevada and that I'm hearing across the country. We do know that there's about 1 in 4 Native Americans experience food insecurity compared to 1 in 9 Americans. I do believe, and I think everybody here believes, that the federal government, Congress, has an obligation to really uphold our trust responsibility to support tribal members and work with tribes and tribal communities to ensure that their basic needs are met. One anomaly that has come to my attention, and this is why Senator Murray and I have introduced legislation, is that a tribal member's inability to use SNAP and FDIPR within the same month cannot occur, right? And so I would, if you can touch on this, maybe Mr. Spaan or any panel member, what impact does this have on our tribes when they are limited to one or the other and they cannot utilize them in the same month, unlike in other areas that we have allowed that to occur?
Yes, Senator, thank you for that question. I believe that the statutory prohibition really limits tribes in being able to develop comprehensive approaches to address food insecurity in their communities. You know, the Self-Determination Demonstration Project through FDIPR has been wonderful in providing tribes with additional flexibilities that they need to implement those programs appropriately. But there's still emergency situations, there's still unpredicted growing seasons, things that can occur where it can displace some foods that are intended for a food distribution program. And in those cases, it'd be nice for tribes to have that option of incorporating SNAP benefits. So whenever they need to, they have these different tools in their toolbox that they can pull upon to devise the best approach for addressing the issues in their local communities.
Well, thank you. And this week, Senator Murray and I introduced legislation to reduce that tribal food insecurity by allowing tribal members who qualify for the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, SNAP, and the Food Distribution Program on Indian Reservations to use both programs in any given month. Let me just ask, does anybody disagree that that is necessary or not necessary? Would everybody agree that this is an important piece of legislation? Ms. Fain? Yes.
It definitely is, and I just want to highlight the current prohibition. It doesn't acknowledge the realities of many tribal members who, due to school or jobs, may be within 1 month on the reservation and may be in a more urban area where they're forced to choose a program that they may not be able to have access to later in the month because of the more kind of mobile nature that a lot of us live in today. So,
correct. Anyone else?
Thank you, Senator. I would just like to touch on my experience in the retail space because the Muscogee Nation does have both the FDIPR program and the retail space, which accepts SNAP. We're sort of uniquely positioned, and I have had conversations with tribal citizens who come in the shop and have lamented the fact that if they were to stop FDIPR, there would be a month or more lapse in their benefit. So not only would they not be able to receive the benefit that month, but they would have to go a full additional month or even longer before they were able to utilize their SNAP benefits, and that really hurts. And overall, it affects the stretch of a dollar because we've had a few sales where they could have gotten more food for the benefit cost if they would have been able to come to the plant and utilize SNAP that month as opposed to going to the FDIPR program. And like I said, it fluctuates a lot of months. The FDIPR program, they get more food to feed those families, but in certain times it would be fantastic if they had the flexibility to be able to switch over without, you know, having to stretch a month or even longer without any benefit. Thank you,
because let me just say, my understanding, there are currently estimated 276 tribes that receive benefits under FDIPR. In the fiscal year 2020, the program served 75,000 Native American adults and children each month. And according to the 2009 Urban Institute study, 87% of FDIPR participants are eligible for SNAP. And so this would make a difference for so many of our community. So I thank you. Thank you for being here. I'll yield the remainder of my time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Senator Daines.
Chairman Schatz, thank you. And thank you, Ms. Fain, for being here to represent the Intertribal Agricultural Council, which is headquartered in Billings. It's where my mom and dad grew up. My dad literally married the girl next door from Billings. It's always a pleasure to highlight the important work being done back home. Farming and ranching, as we all know, is truly the foundation of our economy in Montana. It's our number one economic driver. It's our Montana way of life, and it also plays a very important role in our tribal communities. As the Senate crafts the Farm Bill, it's important to ensure that Montana's tribal ag producers and their voices are heard. Supporting crop insurance, promoting ag research, protecting drought and disaster relief programs, and maintaining important conservation programs are a few of Montana's biggest Farm Bill priorities. The Farm Bill also provides a great opportunity to advance important forest management and conservation reforms. We're already well into fire season, You know, it was the time of year when I'm making those phone calls back to folks on the front lines, to four supervisors, spending time in them back home on the front lines, getting updates on these fires. They're already burning in a significant way in Montana as we speak. And so ensuring that we can advance these forest management priorities to produce more healthy forests, thinned forests, better wildlife habitat, better watersheds, more jobs, and reducing the risk of these catastrophic wildfires are so important. In fact, in 2018, Congress amended the Good Neighbor Authority Program to allow the Forest Service to partner with our tribes to advance some of these vital forest management projects. Some of the stark contrasts I have in my office, I've got pictures. If you take a look at private land, oftentimes state lands, you'll see vibrant green forests. You look at federal lands, you'll see gray, dying, decaying forests, literally seeing the section line running up on the boundary, a dying forest that has not been managed, a vibrant forest that has. And our problem is on national forest ground. It's not on the state grounds. It's not on private ground. There's still a lot of work to be done to ensure that tribes are fully empowered to manage forests and invest in conservation restoration projects, which is why I was glad to support Senator Risch's Treating Tribes and Counties as Good Neighbors Act, so tribes can fully participate in this effective program. To my questions, as the wildfires are now burning in Montana, I'm keenly aware of the urgent need to get on-the-ground management work done. This common sense legislative fix would fully incorporate tribes as partners with the Forest Service by allowing them to retain timber receipts for restoration projects they undertake. It'll keep a great incentive to keep the tribes engaged in forest management. These receipts could then be used by tribes to fund additional work to further protect communities and forests from catastrophic wildfires. Mr. Desautel, you have previously talked about a Good Neighbor Authority project in the Colville National Forest in Washington State that the Colville tribe had to abandon because of the cost. What would the impact be for tribes working to improve forest health if we could successfully expand full Good Neighbor Authority for tribes?
Thank you for the question. So as I noted in my testimony, states have done a great job implementing this authority really since 2014 when it was expanded. But the limitation that tribes have is that we're already limited in the amount of funding we have available, and what we receive from the Bureau of Indian Affairs to do forest management is limited to trust acres. So unless we have access to that program revenue to do the planning and restoration services allowed for with Good Neighbor Authority, those would have to come from tribal dollars and tribal investments in every single situation. And most tribes just don't have adequate funding to manage their own lands, as the most recent IFMAT report showed, in addition to adding those costs to adjacent federal lands, which we know get 3 to 4 times per acre what the tribes do. So if we had a mechanism that allowed us to retain revenue to continue that work, to build staffing and capacity to be able to help our adjacent federal land managers, that would be huge. And I think it would completely solve the problem, and you would see much more utilization of that program.
There couldn't be a better answer. You just gave it. I mean, completely solve, huge. And this is clearly something we can address legislatively. And that's a really important statement you made here for the record in this hearing. So why we need to get this done. Thank you. I often hear from producers in Indian country about the barriers that make it difficult to participate in some of these valuable farm programs. Ensuring fair access to these programs are going to help grow tribal economies, help improve food access, and support infrastructure investment. Ms. Fain, what steps can Congress take to increase tribal access and participation in valuable farm bill programs?
Thank you, Senator. Congress, the way they can do this is to recognize tribes within farm bill provisions and actually tailor existing programs to recognize the unique places that tribes have within USDA. Right now especially, a lot of the programming is administered in a way that leaves tribes out of the process, where it might be, for instance, around disaster and where a drought occurs. I know that a lot of our producers some arbitrary county lines make a difference between whether they're eligible for disaster funding or not. And it's not reflective of the fact that they are operating on tribal lands and a reservation as a whole instead of within a county that, depending on whether where the weather monitor is, may not account for where they are within the reservation. And so being careful and mindful of how these programs are reaching tribal producers or alternatively aren't, because they haven't been designed for input from tribes and individual producers, is an important step to making sure producers do have that same type of access that their neighbors do, who aren't necessarily operating on tribal lands.
Ms. Fain, thank you. Mr. Chairman, thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator Daines. Mr. Price, you know better than most, Hawaii has successfully incorporated traditional ecological knowledge in its agricultural practices, including biocultural restoration, agroforestry, and food systems. Can you share a specific example that shows how traditional conservation practices are best practices?
Mahalo, Senator Schatz. Sorry, I'm off mute. Mahalo for that question. There are many examples that highlight the value of traditional conservation practices in Hawaii, and I'd like to answer that first by pointing out that what we often think of as conservation is to protect land from overdevelopment and just leave it as open space, which oftentimes incentivizes neglect or poor stewardship. And in Hawaii, neglected land actually becomes a threat to surrounding communities as invasive species take root and massive invasive trees, such as albizia or opiuma, can become uprooted projectiles in massive flood events, for example. And we've seen this happen over and over again. Overgrown land also becomes cover for seedy activity that feeds the underbelly of society. So we need to incentivize proper stewardship, and traditional conservation practices are grounded in human engagement and maintenance of land and water resources that is rooted in enhancing ecosystems and increasing productivity of the natural environment. What I hope is that by codifying TEK, we can open the door for greater investment to capture the impacts of TEK work through the use of technology such as environmental sensors, LIDAR, and GPS. It's just a few examples to track environmental data such as soil health, nutrients, and moisture to tell the story of TEK in practice through data. Some sites that are doing this groundbreaking work, to answer your question, are Hanohano Hei'ia on Oahu, Aina Mo'omona and Sustainable Molokai on Molokai, on the island of Molokai, Kumano Ikeala and Waipa Foundation on Kauai. These are just a few, and these are projects that are restoring spaces utilizing traditional conservation practices. I'll be adding a report to the record that was produced by our working group that outlines the input gathered through our engagement process that lists 70 Native Hawaiian producers and practitioners, which all serve as examples of the TEK work happening across Hawaii. And if we can use the Farm Bill to further empower and create investment in that work, this will be transformative for Hawaii and potentially the world. Mahalo.
Thank you, Mr. Price. And I just want to say I have that Aloha shirt, so it's a good thing I didn't wear it today. Mr. Spaan, USDA previously testified that there are structural barriers to 638 expansion with the department. How can we set up USDA for successful expansion of this program?
Thank you, Chairman Schatz. You know, federal agencies identifying structural barriers to self-determination and self-governance, certainly not new. If you look back 70s, 80s, 90s, early as 2010 timeframe, you look at DOI, IHS, Department of Transportation, all presenting barriers that they said it couldn't happen. However, what we've seen is that once everybody comes together, we can make it happen, and fully believe the same would be true at USDA. I do think that having a feasibility study to take a very systematic look at all programs and agencies across USDA could really help to ease some of that uncertainty. What we tend to find is there's a lot of agencies that kind of come up with hypothetical can't do's. And whenever you actually get into the weeds of like, oh, hang on, that's not that difficult to overcome. So I think that systematic look at all the programs that would be beneficial. One thing that, you know, there was a study for HHS feasibility 20 years ago that found it was feasible, and it's never been implemented. So I think that if Congress were to consider giving that flexibility to let USDA initiate some limited demonstration projects when they find a program feasible, that that could be helpful to make sure that this is action-oriented and not just a report that goes on, you know, the bookshelves for 20 years. I also think that the use of demonstration projects has been critical across all agencies that have self-governance authority now. It allows a small number of tribes to participate, work with the agency to identify what the challenges are, how do we overcome these the best way. And, you know, self-governance, self-determination, one of the beauties of it is that it's unique for every single tribe that implements it. So you have a nice kind of sampling of different tribes participate in it. It allows the tribes to work with the agency to overcome the challenges, and it also allows the agency not to get overwhelmed before they're comfortable with it. So I think those would be two recommendations I would have.
Thank you. Just some final thoughts on that. You know, we did a lot in IIJA and IRA to include Native communities in programs that already existed. And I think what we're finding, first of all, that's great news. That's a huge policy victory. But what we're finding is, you know, it's not quite enough to say and Indian tribes and Alaska Natives and Hawaiians, because those people who are administering whatever program they're administering don't know really what that means, and they don't understand the trust relationship, they don't understand the government-to-government relationship, and so they end up interacting with tribes and Native people as though they are just some county subgrantee or some NGO or some trade association. And so I think, as first of all, we have a long way to go to enact a farm bill and all of these provisions in it, but we really have to track implementation, because it's not someone's fault if they work at USDA all their lives and they haven't actually had to interact with tribes, because it hasn't been public policy yet. So I just have a real keen eye towards implementation and seeing Department of Energy, some of these civil servants, longtime civil servants, are just not familiar with the relationship. And I don't want to have a couple of years of failure and then we all point our fingers in the air and why aren't you doing this? I think we have to have an eye towards how hard it's going to be to get agencies that are not accustomed to interacting with sovereigns to do so. So if they're... Senator Murkowski was to say something. That was just a cough. If there are no more questions for our witnesses, members may also submit follow-up written questions for the record. The hearing record will be open for 1 month. I want to thank all of the witnesses, both in person and online, for their time and their testimony today. This hearing is adjourned.